Well, welcome back. If you're here, you've been going through the Constitution, and you're here to check out the powers of the legislative branch, who can be in the legislative branch, and how things really happen within our government. So we're gonna end up going through three branches through these series of videos, but this will be the first one on one of the branches. So without further ado, here we go. So if you read through Article 1 of the United States Constitution, it does establish a Congress that has two houses. Fancy word for that's going to be bicameral. If you ever see the word bicameral, it means to buy. Bi meaning two houses, bicameral. What are the two houses? We have the Senate and the House of Representatives. The Senate is seen as kind of the upper house. The House of Reps is seen as the kind of the lower house, all right? Our Congress, or our legislature, if you will, is the lawmaking branch. So easy way to remember that. The L in legislature, if you remember L meaning laws or legislate to make laws, you should be okay with that, all right? Article 1 gives the qualifications for the election to Congress and describes the rights and privileges of its members. So Article 1 really talks about how do you get inside the Senate, how do you become a senator, and how do you become a member of the House of Representatives. After that, it really distinguishes between the rights of those congressmen and what they can and can't do. Article 1 also lists the specific powers of Congress, including the necessary and proper clause. We discussed that in class as the elastic clause. It allows the government to be flexible. So here we go, right? You should have this chart on the sheet. If you fill it out, that's great. It's right there. You got the representatives, and then you have the senators. So the representatives is based on population. You should remember that from the Great Compromise, right? For as many people as you have live in that state, we do this by a percentage, and you get that many representatives. States with a very large population get more of these guys, right? There are 435 representatives. States like Texas and Florida, New York and California, they have a lot. They have a lot of these people. When you do get elected to the House of Representatives, you serve for 2 years, and you are elected by the voters in your district. So it's not the entire people of the state who are voting for these residents or, these representatives that we have. It's members of districts. So each state is cut up into however many districts that it has representatives. All right. What do you got to be? You got to be 25 years or older. You have to be a citizen for 7 years. It doesn't say natural born citizen, just says you have to be a citizen, and you got to live in that state that you were elected from. So there's the House. When we look at the Senate, it doesn't matter how big a state is or how small a state is, doesn't matter the population at all whatsoever. In the Senate, everything is equal. So everybody gets two senators per state. When you do get elected to the Senate, you serve for 6 years. The original Constitution said that each state legislature, so the members, like say if we take New York, we're going to elect people to work in Albany to make laws for New York State. Those people used to pick the state senators. They would pick them. It was just, they can choose who those two senators are. Today, it is very different. The 17th Amendment, we directly elect those senators today. So those people are elected, those two senators are going to be elected by the people. To get to the Senate, what do you got to be? 30 years or over. You have to be a citizen for 9 years. It does not say natural born citizen, it just says a citizen. And you have to live in the state in which you were elected. So nice little chart on the breakdown of the representatives and the senators. All right. There are a few separate or special powers that the House of Representatives and the Senate has. So when we take a look at these, you kind of see them, right? To win the presidency, an individual needs a majority of electoral college votes. Have been a couple times throughout our history where there has not been a candidate who has got the majority of the electoral vote. In those instances, all the members of the House of Representatives are going to vote to see who the president is. So they have that special power of electing a president only if no president has a majority of the electoral college vote. All right. And the same thing in the Senate. The Senate may do for the vice president if the same thing, there's no majority of the Electoral College vote. I've never seen that happen. I've seen this happen, but not this. The House can't impeach the president. Now, we talked about impeachment before. That specifically means you're going to charge an elected official with doing something wrong. Does not mean you're guilty. Does not mean we're going to throw the president out of office. All right. So, how the impeachment works is, the House of Representatives determines if we should charge the president or another elected official. The Senate, those 100 people, then acts as the jury. So they're going to listen to the case, listen to the evidence, hear testimony, and then they're going to actually vote on impeachment. And when you look at that, if the Senate two-thirds of the Senate vote to impeach someone, well, then they will be officially charged. They may be removed from office. All right. The other major power of the House of Representatives, they begin any discussions on spending money. The Senate can't talk about spending any kind of money until the House does. The President can't talk about spending any kind of money until the House does. So they talk about all governmental spending begins in the House of Representatives. President makes treaties, but before a treaty is valid, before it is ratified, it has to go through the Senate. And they, if any deal the President makes, any type of treaty he makes, sure he can do. He's well within his rights to do. It does not become a valid treaty until two-thirds of the Senate agree to it. So in short, the President can do anything he wants, but the Senate has to ratify his treaties. All right. President's going to appoint a lot of different people: federal judges, Supreme Court judges, cabinet positions, ambassadors to foreign countries. So the President is going to make appointments. He's going to pick people to do certain things. Those people do not get that job until the Senate agrees to it. So that's another special privilege of the Senate. House has their special privileges, and so does the Senate. Nice. We're just talking about the lawmaking process, all right? Let's get the terminology down first. Anytime you hear something about a bill or an idea for a law, this is, someone comes up with kind of an idea. Like the easiest one to pick is it's nice and easy because kids know it. Someone back in the day said that the bus has to stop on the railroad tracks, open the door, peek both ways before going over. Why? It's a good idea for a whole busload of kids not to get whacked by a big train. So before, that was just a bill. There was an idea that someone had, and eventually that bill or that idea became a law. So we're going to take a quick look at that process that takes place. So for that bill to become a law, it requires the approval of the House of Representatives, the Senate, and the President. So though all three of those kind of sub branches in the House and the Senate and the presidency have to agree. A president, if he doesn't like a particular law, does have the right to veto it. If he doesn't like it, he can say, you know what, I don't think you guys made the law, Congress made the law, that's great. I don't think it's a good law, so I'm going to veto it. What does that mean? I'm going to reject it. I'm not going to sign it. And then, luckily for Congress, the idea for that law is not done. They got one more shot at it. And if that bill is, they vote on it again, Congress can vote on it. And if they vote with a two-thirds vote, which is way more than a majority, right? Two-thirds of Congress, it still becomes a law. All right. The bill must also pass through many numerous committees before becoming a law. So these committees is really where the grunt work is done in Congress. They work on the language, they decide if the law is worth it, and then they take care of that. So let's take a particular law and run it through so you have an idea. All right. Somebody's got to introduce it. So the laws are introduced either in the House or the Senate. Quick rule of thumb, if it has to do with money, got to begin in the House, got to begin here. But let's take our little yellow bus driving over the railroad tracks, right? So someone says, hey, that's a good idea for a law. Well, they send it to a committee, usually probably the Committee on Transportation or the Committee on Safety or something like that. So they discuss it. They write the language down. They actually, write the law down, work on the words, make sure it says exactly what they mean it to say. They debate about it. They vote on it. If it passes, it then goes to the Senate. They introduce it, the language that they all wrote down. They send it to their committee and discuss it, and then they vote on it. So before the law even gets to the president, it has to get through the Senate and get through the House in the same language. So they're going to send it through all these committees in this whole process. If there's any differences, sometimes they come up with like a conference committee, or they'll get together and they'll discuss those things. They'll work on the language together, both House and Senate. If the House votes on it, a majority, over 50%, and they like it. If the Senate votes on it, majority, they like it. It goes to the president. If he signs it, it simply becomes a law. So you got a nice idea here of a nice little graph of how bills actually become laws, right? Something we may have touched upon in class, or if you're not sure, there's something known as the unwritten constitution. Two things that kind of happen in our Congress. So the unwritten Constitution are things that just kind of happen over time. They're not written down, but they're part of our politics. A couple of good ideas would be the president's cabinet, political parties, only serving 2 terms. These are things that just kind of, we see them as part of our politics, but you will not find them in the Constitution, all right? And Congress does a lot of their work in these committees. You won't find the word committee in the Constitution. Congress developed these things afterwards because that's how they felt they can get the most work done. So the committee system would be an example of the unwritten Constitution. Committees, what do? They control what bills include, which ones go for a vote, how the language looks, whether we should waste any more time on them or not. What if a committee finds that it's really not a great law, it's not a great idea, we shouldn't be doing this? They just scrap it and they move on to doing something else, all right? There are a lot of discussions in the House and the Senate, and when we look at those debates, there are certain rules for that. So, debate in the House of Representatives is limited. They set time constraints on how long they're going to spend on certain items. Why do they do that? So they can keep moving, so they can keep getting things done. The problem in the Senate is there is no limit on the amount of time things can be debated. So if a certain congressman doesn't want a bill or an idea for a law to go to a vote, what they will do is they will do something kind of a sneaky little move called a filibuster. They will just continue to talk so that they can't get to the vote. And they're legally able to do that. Why? Because there is no limit in the Senate. There's no limit on the discussion time. Famous filibuster, a guy pulled out a phone book, started reading the names off it. All you got to do is continue to talk and you can block a vote. Now, recently, what Congress has came up with, and this is where what the Senate has come up with, they said, listen, we got to get things done. So they come up with this idea of what's called a cloture. If somebody is going to filibuster, if they're just going to waste time and talk because they don't want the vote to happen, what the Senate can do is say, before we waste all that time, let's vote. If 60 out of the 100 senators say that, listen, we are going to move on. What a cloture is basically, hey, we're not going to vote on it, but we're not going to discuss anymore. We got to move on. So that would be like they're just pushing that off to the side so they can continue to do other things. So those are two little funky things that happen only in the Senate. Those things do not happen in the House of Reps. Why? Because there's already a limit. Here, no limit. You got these funky things that happen. So you got that. I know in class we wrote this down. I'm going to move through fast so you got them. There are things that are called expressed powers. They are written down in the Constitution. And some of them kind of allow us to understand specifically what Congress can do. So there's certain powers they have during peace. Can Congress collect taxes? Simple answer, yes. Can Congress borrow money? Yes. The other thing that I know we kind of talked about in class is these things are things that the president cannot do. So you want to be clear on that, right? These are things the president cannot do. These are specifically powers of Congress, right? They regulate foreign trade. Congress also regulates trade between states. That issue is going to pop up a bunch of times in class. Congress controls interstate trade. Naturalization and bankruptcy law is pretty simple. They determine what you got to do to become a citizen, right? Congress determines who is going to coin money, only the federal government, and regulate its value. They also regulate the weights and measures of the country, right? Congress will determine the punishment for counterfeiters, fancy word for people who are printing money in their basement. All right, very illegal. It's a federal crime. You're going to go to federal prison. Congress controls the post offices, postal roads. I know I mentioned in class you beat up the postman. That's on you. That's a federal crime because those people work for the federal government. All right. Congress can grant patents and copyrights. If you have an original idea for a piece of technology, or you want to make a technology better, you want to get a patent for that. You want the rights to that. That's called your intellectual property. So you want that. Congress actually creates courts that are lower than the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court is created by the Constitution. It says it in there. Lower courts created by Congress. Congress can define any piracies or felonies or any violent stuff that's happening on the high seas. So if you do something wrong out in the middle of the ocean, Congress is going to determine your punishment. All right. The last thing, they can exercise the exclusive jurisdiction over the District of Columbia. They also have control over any forts or dockyards, national parks, federal buildings, anything that else is created like that, Congress has control of. So those are kind of things that Congress does during peacetime or even during war, but those are kind of their peace powers. We will touch upon the war powers of Congress. The first one's probably the biggest one. All right. The president cannot do this. Congress can. What can Congress do? You guessed it. Declare war. Congress is the only one that can do that. It is not the president. It is not the Supreme Court. Congress determines how big our armies, our navies, our military is. They also support that army and navy in terms of money and resources and things like that. Congress provides and maintains the navy. How big? How much money we're going to spend on it? Congress determines that. They're also going to make the laws for our army and navy. They're going to make the laws for our naval forces and our navy. Congress is also in control for calling for the local militia. Today we don't call it that. We may refer to that as kind of the state forces or where the National Guard is. All right. Provide for organizing and arming and disciplining that militia. It's just another thing that kind of the same thing. 18. Kind of one of the biggest things you need to know about Congress. Now that you've wrote down all the powers of Congress, you know specifically what they can do because we wrote this stuff down. There's something called implied powers. And these aren't necessarily written down. They're tougher to figure out. But the 18th clause of Congress's power says Congress can make laws, any law they feel is necessary and proper. We refer to this as the elastic clause. So what does that mean? They can define and provide punishment for federal crimes. They've established the Federal Reserve System that keeps track of our money in terms of its value. They can improve rivers, canals, harbors. The Constitution doesn't say that, but they can do that if they feel it's what? Necessary and proper. So this allows the government to do more, right? So test tips. You got to know the difference between the House and the Senate. Know the importance of that last clause that I mentioned. It will pop up over and over and over again. And then, of course, know the powers of Congress, both the ones that are written down and the ones that are implied through the necessary and proper clause. If you read all this, you go to the video, you should have the Congress down. If you don't, watch it again. See you soon.